I know my fate. One day my name will be associated with a memory of something tremendous. A crisis without equal on Earth. The most profound collision of conscience, conjured up against everything that had been believed, demanded, hallowed so far. Where you see ideals, I see what is human. Alas, all too human.
These are the words of the visionary German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche. The crisis he is predicting was the crisis of religious faith that would sweep through Europe in the late 19th century. Nietzsche was the first thinker to realize that the death of God would give birth to something entirely new in human history. The idea of absolute freedom, of man as the sole measure of the universe. What he was describing was nothing less than the birth pangs of the modern world.
Nietzsche is as important as Marx, Freud, and Einstein in the revolution of the way people think in the 20th century. The chief effect of Nietzsche on the 20th century has been a tremendous loosening up of moral certainties and intellectual certainties. People no longer know for sure what is good and evil, what is right and wrong.
God is dead, and God remains dead because we have killed him. How shall we, the murderers of all murderers, comfort ourselves? What was holiest and most powerful of all that the world has yet owned has bled to death under our knives. Who will wipe the blood from our hands?
Hitherto, the church had been the arbiter of morals, the giver of moral truth. The idea that there isn't a fixed truth, the capital T, seems to us now quite commonplace in the 20th century. But Nietzsche was really a pioneer of this position. It seems to us very simple today, because I think that we've more or less, all of us, taken it on board. The idea that we're not determined by some outside forces, that life is there for the making, that you make your choices, you develop yourself through your own effort.
I think of Nietzsche as the first great punk philosopher. I see him there in the Pantheon with a safety pin stuck through his nose and two fingers thrust up in the general direction of the philosophic pantheon. And that is a positive aspect of him. As it were, paradoxically, in his most apparent nihilism, he seems to me also to be the most apparently positive of thinkers, because he's enjoining people to do it themselves in that way. His philosophy is not a guide that you should think like him, it's a guide that you should think for yourself.
Although Nietzsche was a great liberator, the kind of freedom he helped bring into being was also a terrible burden. He was all too aware that the death of God had left a void where certainties once existed. In order to fill it, he tried to do something which no one before him had ever attempted, and for which he would pay a heavy price.
He wanted to be the moralist of the new post-God society. So he was setting himself a task that he couldn't possibly fulfill. No one could fulfill that task. And without suggesting crudely or simplistically that he copped out by retreating into madness, I do think that some such escape was inevitable.
It's almost a subject for a play, is what went on in Nietzsche's mind those last fateful days before he was found in a state of dementia, whether or not those last few days reflected some hideous awakening or re-evaluation of all his own values.
Nietzsche's momentous philosophical journey ended at the age of 44 in insanity. How far did the responsibility he took upon himself as a thinker in the end destroy him as a human being? On his passage into the unknown, Did he discover the ultimate truth about what it really means to be human, all too human?
By the time one has grown up, one remembers only the truly salient points concerning one's earliest childhood. The sequence of years flits past my gaze like a confused dream. Nevertheless, several things remain vivid and vital in my soul, and of these things, combined with what is obscure and gloomy, I shall paint my picture. I was born in Roken, near Lutzen, on October the 15th, 1844. I received in holy baptism the name Friedrich Wilhelm. My father was the preacher of this village, the perfect picture of a country parson, gifted in spirit and heart, adorned with all the virtues of a Christian. He lived a tranquil, simple, yet happy life.
In der Taufpredigt benutzte der Vater den Taufspruch: Was meint ihr, will aus diesem Kindlein werden? Gutes oder Böses? Und im Anschluss beschrieb er also, was alles aus einem Kindlein werden kann. Welche Sünden und welche Versuchungen eigentlich auf so einen jungen Menschen zukommen können. Und er machte also diese radikale Dichotomie auf, des Guten und des Bösen. Nietzsche wird später einen Text schreiben, den er nennt Jenseits von Gut und Böse. Und Nietzsche hat zeitlebens versucht, diese radikalen Entgegensetzungen zu relativieren, sie aufeinander zu beziehen, sie voneinander abhängig zu machen.
Nietzsche's early childhood was probably the happiest time in his life. A baby sister was born when he was two, and a brother followed a year later. But in 1847, catastrophe struck, when Nietzsche's father was diagnosed with a terminal brain disease.
Im Juli 1849 ist sein Vater gestorben und im Januar 1850 ist danach dann sein kleiner Bruder gestorben. Nietzsche hat seinen Vater immer als eine Art weltliche und geistige Autorität erlebt und musste nun zusehen, wie er über ein Jahr lang mit sehr großen Leidenszuständen zu ringen hatte. Und der Gott, für den sein Vater eigentlich da ist, dessen Diener er ist, straft diesen Vater mit so sehr viel Leiden. Das kann eventuell auch ausschlaggebend sein, dass also Nietzsche frühzeitig in der Naumburger Zeit schon am Christentum zweifelt.
Nietzsche was just five when he lost his father and brother. He moved with his mother and sister to the nearby town of Naumburg and was then sent to boarding school at Schulpforte, 5 miles away, an establishment with a long tradition in religious education.
By the time we moved to Naumburg, my character began to show itself. I had already experienced considerable sadness and grief in my young life, and was therefore not as carefree and as wild as children usually are. My schoolmates were accustomed to teasing me on account of my seriousness. From childhood on, I sought solitude, and I felt best whenever I could give myself over to myself, undisturbed.
Well, this is his school leaving certificate, and it gives us more information than only his marks. It says that he is a diligent pupil, that he behaved well, and about his lessons in religious education, it says that he showed a lively interest in the teachings of Christianity, and he learned them very eagerly and easily.
In later life, Nietzsche would declare himself to be the Antichrist, but for now he betrayed no such sentiment. After leaving school, he went on to study theology at Bonn University, with a view to becoming a priest like his father before him. But on Easter Sunday, 1865, he refused to attend Holy Communion with his family at the local church in Naumburg. Later that year, he gave up his religious vocation altogether in order to study languages as a classical philologist. In a letter to his sister Elizabeth, he explained his reasons.
I write this to you, dear Elizabeth, only in order to counter the most usual proofs of believers. Every true faith is infallible. It performs what the believing person hopes to find in it, but it does not offer the least support for the establishing of an objective truth. Here, the ways of men divide. If you want to achieve peace of mind and happiness, have faith. If you want to be a disciple of truth, then search.
One often finds with Nietzsche that there is a crisis and a delayed reaction to it. This is very much the case with his abandonment of religion as well, so that the Antichrist, which is his most explicit statement against Christianity and against religion in general, comes over 20 years after he himself has abandoned the faith. He writes about his works as memorials to crises.
Nietzsche's most provocative attack on religion came in the parable of the madman, written late in his life, and which famously proclaimed the death of God.
Ich suche Gott. Wo ist Gott?
Have you not heard of that madman who lit a lantern in the bright morning hours, ran to the marketplace and cried incessantly, I seek God, I seek God? As many of those who do not believe in God were standing around just then, he provoked much laughter. Why? Did he get lost? Said one. Did he lose his way like a child? Said another. Or is he hiding? The madman jumped into their midst and pierced them with his glances. Where is God? He cried. I shall tell you. We have killed him, you and I. All of us are his murderers.
The madman is clearly offering some kind of warning that there's a tremendous cataclysm on its way. I think what's important for Nietzsche is that there's a number of events, let's call them intellectual events of the 19th century, which put together all work towards undermining the very foundations of Christian moral civilization.